What's going on, everybody? Welcome back to the channel. Madden 20 is here, and I'm happy to announce that we have a brand new franchise kicking off today. It is time to begin the Tampa Bay Buccaneers franchise. Last year in Madden 19, we had a little stint with the Miami Dolphins, and unfortunately that did not go as planned. But here in Tampa Bay, a chance for a brand new journey and a different experience from what we've done previously back in Madden 19 with the Dolphins and obviously Madden 18 with the Bears franchise. If you enjoy rebuilds, boy, do I have some great news for you. This franchise series, one of the two I'm doing on the channel this year, will be more of a simulation, sit back and watch and commentate series as opposed to what I did in the previous 2 years. Obviously, we'll talk about the other one when the time is right. Still working out the kinks with that one. So entering a brand new owner's mode with Sean Kelly, former Illinois Tech quarterback, and obviously a much better money manager than he was a professional player, as he spent a little bit of time in the NFL before calling it quits and eventually becoming an owner. And his big task is giving Bruce Arians the team he needs to hopefully get this team moving in the right direction. But the challenge we have ahead of us is not going to be an easy one to get around. Let's take a look at the Buccaneers roster, which seemed like it was pretty good from the initial franchise screen. But as you see, Mike Evans and Lavonte David are the only 90-plus overall players. Olimar Petz in 88, Damar Dotson in 86. Here we are moving into the low 80s with Chris Godwin and Vita Vea. Cameron Brate to 79, and as you'll see, this roster, the overalls are very quickly moving through the 70s, barely a quarter of the way through the roster, now in the low 70s, and eventually we reach the 60s. And that, unfortunately, is where a pretty heavy portion of this roster sits. Of course, that has a lot to do with the rating shift this year, and a lot of players are now going to fall into that 70s, high 60s overall range, but we even have some starters that are in the low 60s, and that needs to change very quickly. One of the big stories for, I guess, the first couple of years is going to be what happens to Jameis Winston. It's been a bit of a roller coaster with the former number one overall pick, who's now entering his fifth year. He has star development. He's an improviser archetype quarterback, a 76 overall, and the scheme fit strong arm is nearly there. Good arm with 90 throw power, accuracies are all in the 80s, good throw on the run, break sacks at 91. He's also got mobility, but can Winston put together a year that makes me think that he could stick around and be the franchise quarterback? Because if you look at his numbers from his rookie year, 22 touchdowns, 15 interceptions, then 28 and 18, 19 and 11, and then even last year he started poorly, got benched, and then came back and threw 19 touchdowns, 14 interceptions. Turnovers need to go down, and it's not like we really have a quarterback to challenge Winston for the starting job. Blaine Gabbert's the backup, obviously. He's not going to be doing much with 81 throw power and accuracies that aren't really that great. It seems like every team in the NFL has that star running back or that player they can depend on to move the football, and Tampa Bay for several years has not had that guy. Peyton Barber was the guy the Buccaneers leaned on most of last year. In his final year on contract out of Auburn, fourth year in the league, he is an elusive back who's got a little bit of power, 88 speed, good elusiveness. Trucking's also there. The problem is, when you're talking about a starting running back in today's NFL, you need to be able to catch the football, and Peyton Barber is not that guy. 871 on the ground last year, plus 5 scores, only fumbled once. A lot of people thought that Ronald Jones II would be the saving grace for Tampa Bay and lead this ground game last season, and that was pretty much the opposite. Jones only played 9 games last year, 23 attempts, 44 yards, under 2 yards a carry, and only 1 score. Didn't really do much. The receiving core, I think, could be special. Mike Evans, despite everything happening the past couple of years in Tampa Bay, this guy has found a way to produce, and he is the only superstar X factor on this roster. We'll talk about the one that got snubbed in a minute, but Mike Evans, he has the speed to win with his size. He can box out, he can make all the catches. He has failed to have a under 1,000 yard receiving year, and even with the turmoil at quarterback last year, he still put up 1,500 yards and 8 touchdowns. Mike Evans is a problem, and he's locked down for several years. Mike Evans is one of those guys during this series I would love to have retire as a Buccaneer. Hopefully, he feels the same way. Chris Godwin on the other side of the field is a rising star in this league. He has star development. He's only 23. 30-yard at Penn State. He's got the speed. Gets off the line pretty well. Great hands in traffic. Spec catch also there. Chris Godwin just needs, I guess, just a little more attention. Maybe the targets need to go up. 842 last year. 7 scores. Much better than his rookie season. And of course, he's still on a rookie contract. So an 81 overall now, where will he be at the end of 2 seasons? Not too sure. So we talked about our 2 outside receivers. Who's playing in the slot this year is a big question. Obviously, you have Breshad Perriman. Drop man. Yeah, that's him. I won't do that again. Perriman, known for ball security issues. 74 catch in traffic seems about right. He got a little better last year, but obviously he is known for his inability to hold on to the football, and you can see the numbers throughout his career. Well, it doesn't show the drops, but you can see he hasn't really had a big impact on any team he's played for. Could he turn the corner with the Buccaneers this season? Potentially, or maybe that role will go to Justin Watson, who has the ability to hold on to the ball in traffic. The speed's there, the route running needs a little bit of work. Or maybe that role goes to rookie Scott Miller out of Bowling Green State. 5'9", 174, a bit small, but Miller's highlight tape from Bowling Green last year, pretty impressive. Good speed, he's got hands in traffic, route running again needs work. I mean, at the minimum, Miller will be playing special teams as the primary returner. Moving on to the tight end position, O.J. Howard. Third year in the league out of Alabama, star development, 84 overall. He has the speed, he has the hands, he runs good routes. I think his run blocking is in a pretty decent place for a vertical threat tight end. He obviously needs more attention. 565 and 5 scores. Again, you know, 60 yards per game is not bad, but that needs to improve. Cameron Brait, I will admit, I am a bit surprised he has star dev, but the more star dev we have, the better. Brait entering his 6th year out of Harvard. He's 28 years old, and he's not bad. You know, we have a good 2 tight end system potentially. I do need to go into our game plan and make sure that we're running a few more 2 tight end sets with the Bruce Arians playbook. And here's where I guess I'm a little confused as to why he's star development. I guess the touchdowns, if he's more of a red zone threat, it makes sense, but the yardage numbers aren't great. The offensive line also isn't great. We start with left tackle Donovan Smith, who's a 67 overall. I think that falls within that low quality starter overall range. And he's 27, 5th year out of Penn State. Good strength, pass blocking is decent, but he cannot run block to save his life. And it wouldn't be as bad of a player if we weren't paying him the money we were paying him. 12.5 for Smith this year. In 2020, he's making 14.5, and in 2021, making $14.3 million. This is a bad contract, and it's one I don't plan on being stuck with in the near future. Ollie Marpet at left guard, his contract I get. Marpet, 26 years old, 6'4", 307, with star development, 88 overall, and there's a reason he's getting paid the money he's being paid this year. He's a near 90 across everything. Strength, run block, pass block, run block power. The only things not near 90 are finesse for pass block and lead block, but obviously that can change very soon. And he's got the speed to pull and do all the things he needs to do with 73 speed. And the great thing is Marpet's locked down until 2023, so if his contract was expiring this year, it would be very expensive, nowhere near this friendly as far as the yearly salary goes to keep him around. At center, there's Ryan Jensen. One thing I also need to point out is that we don't have a lot of quality backups either. Ryan Jensen's 28 years old out of CSU Pueblo, 6'4", 319, 76 overall, normal development, and not a bad player. Not a bad player at all. 90 strength, pass block's good, run block's good, lead block is good. Awareness is 87, so that's obviously a good place to start. And he's locked down until 2021, so 3 years for Jensen at $10 million a year. It's not bad. Regression shouldn't really be knocking him off too far once we get these upgrades rolling. At right guard, I consider this one of our biggest challenges heading into next year, or at least the offseason. is getting this situation at right guard fixed. Earl Watford, 85 strength, mid-60s for pretty much everything important. Not very good. The great thing is, at least the Buccaneers aren't giving him $14 million a year. If I'm being honest, we're probably just going to replace him in the draft. It'd be very hard to not find an upgrade for Earl Watford. And then we move on to right tackle. Ollie Marpet was the number one left guard in the league. And Damar Dotson, who is our star right tackle at 33 years old, is the number four right tackle in the NFL. Fantastic pass blocker, should keep Winston upright this year and maybe our new quarterback next year if that's the direction we go. I do plan on re-signing Dotson if he doesn't retire. Moving on over to the defense, we start with left end William Golston, and of course this is a 3-4 defense, so building this team will be a little different for me, but Golston is entering his seventh year. He's 28 years old out of Michigan State, and Golston really doesn't do anything well. Power move not there, finesse not there, block shed also not there, and it's not like he's producing at a high level, so finding a left end will be very important. That puts more pressure on free agent acquisition in Ndamukong Suh, who's an 85 overall, a 32 years old star development, and a guy that I look very forward to having on this team with the departure of Gerald McCoy. It's a pretty even trade-off between the two. Both very strong, and Ndamukong Suh, 98 strength, great against the run with that block shed rating, and only under contract for 1 year. So we're talking 9.25 this year. I imagine next year he's probably looking for a contract that's very similar. Sticking with the interior defensive line, we have defensive tackle, second-year player Vita Vea. 80 overall already. I admit he was a bit of a surprise pick for me last year for the Buccaneers, but I hope that he plays well. Only 3 sacks last year, that definitely needs to improve. I'll admit it here before people yell at me during the offseason video, but I am horrible at picking up edge rushers, and Shaquille Barrett needs to play big if I want to keep him around. Barrett's talent obviously there, the speed, the block shed, the finesse move, he could be a great player. But he's going to have to play big, because between him and Carl Nassib, I'm only keeping one of these guys. Nassib doesn't have star development, which is okay. He's 6'7", 275, so great range with those long arms. And if you compare the ratings between Nassib and Barrett, they're pretty similar players outside of development and that 2 overall difference. Nassib did have a better year last year, 6 sacks for him, so that is one thing to note. He's also, again, on the final year of his contract, making $2 million this year, and potentially making even more next season with another team, potentially. Anthony Nelson, the rookie out of Iowa, again, 6'7", 270-plus pounds, great size on him. I really like the tape I saw from him last year, and I do kind of want to consider moving him to right outside linebacker where he is the scheme fit, because he has the talent, he has the traits. It's just getting him on the field so we can earn the XP to upgrade and become a better player. Middle linebacker is where things get interesting, and here's the player I really feel got snubbed when it came to development trait. There's no way Lavonte David isn't a superstar, at the minimum. X factor, superstar should have been. 90 overall, does pretty much everything, can rush the passer, can stop the run, can cover, and you can see his production has been incredible since day one. Last year, 120 tackles, 3 sacks, and on the final 2 years of his deal with Tampa Bay, he's 29. Maybe he doesn't come back, because by the time we get to that point, Devin White, I hope, is developed fully, or at least to the point where he's reliable enough. 74 overall now. I doubt they gave him X-Factor development, so with Superstar Dev, he should become a great player very soon. He's got the speed, he's the fastest middle linebacker in Madden 20. The other intangibles are also pretty solid. It's just about getting out there and making the plays you need to make, and with Kendall Beckwith hurt, I don't envision us sitting Devin White for Deion Buchanan at all. I don't understand what his role is. 88 speed, can't cover, can't get off blocks. I guess he can tackle well, but that's pretty much it. Jason Pierre-Paul is hurt. Obviously broken tailbone. He's going to be out for most of the year. And with him making the money that he's making, I really doubt he's sticking around next year. He's likely being cut sometime after he gets healthy. We have Noah Spence, who is playing in relief. Spence near an upgrade, so he won't be a 72 overall for much longer. In his fourth year in the league out of Kentucky, he's got good speed, finesse move is there, good pursuit, play recognition, awareness. The problem is, Spence is on the final year of his deal. Had a decent rookie year the last 2 years, not so much. So again, going back to Nelson, that right outside backer job could be his. Let's talk about the secondary that was ranked, I think, bottom three in the league last year against the pass. And Vernon Hargreaves is, man, what a, I don't want to say disappointment, but man, he has not played up to first round potential for this organization. Obviously, the shoulder injury and their season opener last year did not help matters much, but even then, the first 2 years, especially 2017, have not been great. A guy that could be a rising star for this secondary, and I hope it's true, is rookie out of Central Michigan, Sean Murphy Bunting, taken second round this year. His dev traits hit, and obviously that's going to be superstar dev because they're not going to give IRL rookies X-factor traits. It's just not going to happen, especially for a second rounder. He's got the speed. He's very comparable to Hargreaves. It's not going to take him long to shoot up the depth chart. He could be number one corner by the bye week. Unfortunately, this is the only really positive news about our secondary this year. Moving on to safety, Justin Evans, third year out of Texas A&M. He's 24 years old. I just don't know what to say. The secondary just isn't good against coverage for the most part. Evans, 87 speed, subpar coverage skills. I think he'd be much better playing at strong safety. I'll probably make that switch before the season begins because that's primarily box players. Mike Edwards, who is a rookie out of Kentucky, I think could be groomed into a pretty decent free safety. He's a little quicker at 88 speed. And high 60s coverage is obviously much better than low 60s coverage. Strong safety, MJ Stewart Jr., 23 years old. He is a pretty decent player. Hybrid safety, 87 speed, 67 zone, 71 man. Could work with that, but I'd prefer not to. Moving on to kicker, Matt Gay, the rookie out of Utah, is going to be the starting kicker this year. 94 power, 77 accuracy, which might not be great for simulating, but is much better than 68 accuracy for Cairo Santos. So Santos likely getting cut because the roster has to get down to 53 players, I believe. We're at 72, maybe 73. Here's Bradley Pinion. Cam Loudermilk is on the Buccaneers practice squad. I was hoping he would be in here with his Pat McAfee celebrations, but maybe next year, EA. Maybe next year. Pinion, not bad though. So let's take a look at schemes. We're running a vertical zone run, which is my preferred scheme. It's actually an 82%, which is pretty surprising. And our defense is a 3-4 under, which is a 92%. Obviously, having a high scheme fit percentage is great, but when your players are bad and they fit the scheme, it doesn't really matter. Here's a look at the new lineup screen. This is kind of cool. So you have your layout of all your players, Mike Evans, OJ Howard, Jameis Winston. The offensive line obviously needs a lot of work. I think Sean Murphy Bunting and Devin White are future stars of this series. And I think that's the big thing about this series. There's a lot of growth that needs to happen with our younger players. We aren't going to see instant success with the way that the ratings have been scaled. We're not going to see rookies that step in and completely dominate like what we had with the Bears franchise and that defensive line that I miss so much. I miss that front line. I miss that front seven. I really miss that whole defense. That was such a great defense. And that's the kind of defense I want to build here. Dominant front line, great secondary players that can do pretty much everything. So here we are looking at Bruce Arians. Again, I don't know how much longer Bruce Arians is going to be here. He could be here in Tampa Bay for a few years and then retire, leaving us to try to fill a void. For now, we don't have expert scouting. We do, though, have wide receiver free agency influence and also QB training boosts. And this is going to be such a big thing for not only Jameis Winston, but potentially the quarterback who's here next year. Winston's on his final year. Do we resign him? At this point, I don't know. Taking a look at team value, the Buccaneers rank 30th in the league. Fan happiness, obviously not high. Team success, not high. Popularity, not high. Staff is pretty decent. Our stadium needs work, which is why I'm doing an owner's mode, because I want to control finances and I want to get this stadium upgraded so we can start selling tickets and start selling merchandise so that way we can afford higher signing bonuses, essentially. That is what it's all about. We're not going to be renovating. We won't be relocating. Taking a look at our staff, Arians is signed through 2022, so hopefully not retiring before then. We have a level 13 scout signed through 2021 with wide receiver overall. And of course, our trainer has regression that is ranked very poorly. He's a bad, bad trainer. Taking a look at the Buccaneers schedule, the Steelers, Dolphins, Browns, and Cowboys during the preseason. We kick off week one of the regular season at home against the Buccaneers, then travel to Carolina. Thursday night, we have the Giants, week three, traveling to the West Coast, week four to play the Rams, Saints week five, Panthers at home week six, bye week week seven, at Tennessee in week eight. We'll probably see a much different team before that trade deadline. Seahawks week nine in Seattle. We've got Kyler Murray and the Cardinals week 10, Saints for the second time week 11, Falcons for the first time week 12, then the Jaguars, Colts, Lions, Texans, and to close off the year, we have week 17 at home against the Falcons. Should be a fun year. It's also going to be very difficult, so I look forward to hopefully not getting our butts kicked every single game. Because we'll be watching games and not actually playing them, the game will be on all pro 10-minute quarters. I'm still working on XP sliders, and I'm still considering whether or not I need to make changes to the gameplay sliders because I feel like everything from what I've seen so far is good. The only issue is sometimes quarterbacks are a little too accurate. Those completion percentages are a little too high. I will be making a lot of tweaks, though, to the penalties. There was that one patch that happened in Madden 19, like halfway through the year, that jacked up face mask call penalties, and that is still an issue here in Madden 20, so I will be lowering that number. But that, everybody, will do it for this video. Week 1 preseason will be next. We'll likely end up simming the 4 preseason games and watching Week 1 at home against the 49ers. Those of you that watch this series format on Mr. Hurricane's channel, we're going to be following that very closely. We'll sim a few games and then we'll watch a game. And as the team gets better, I do envision us watching more games than we're simming. Obviously, a bulk of our seasonal progression will be done through simming, but we go from maybe watching 4 to 5 games a year to maybe watching 6 or 7 games, excluding the playoffs. So I hope you guys enjoyed. I will catch you all next time as we are still waiting for them to fix the issue with scrambling quarterbacks during simulation not running. Like you could sim an entire season right now with Lamar Jackson or Cam Newton, and they're not going to have any rushing stats or barely any, which obviously shouldn't be the case. So that's going to be fixed hopefully sometime soon. I do also want to consider kind of holding out and waiting for the first roster update. That'll probably happen sometime next week, but I really don't want to wait that long. We might not wait for it, but thank you guys for tuning in. Hope you enjoyed. I will catch you next time for more Buccaneers football. See you then.